In this video, we're going to start by computing the integral of the inverse cosine of 1 over x. And this involves the trigonometric substitution followed by integration by parts. Next, we address an interesting complication that happens when you check your answer with a computer algebra system. For example, wxMaxima and wolfram alpha both produce a solution that looks radically different from what you get by hand. And finally, we're going to prove that those two solutions are equivalent. And the key to this problem is to make a trigonometric substitution. We're going to replace 1 over x with cosine theta. And the whole point of this is that then the inverse cosine is going to undo that cosine and we'll get something simpler. Well, we also have to transform the differential dx. And to get that done, we need to solve for x first. So x is 1 over cosine theta, and that's the secant of theta. And now we can get our differential. The derivative of secant is secant tangent. So dx is secant theta tangent theta d theta. Now we transform our integral to theta space. And the inverse cosine of the cosine of theta, that simplifies to just theta. And we recognize this as an integration by parts type integral. If I let u equal that theta out in front, then the differential of that is going to become simpler. dv is going to be the rest of this thing. So again, if u equals theta, du is just d theta. We're usually picking a u so that its derivative is simpler than the original choice of the function. Then for our choice of dv, we're hoping it's easy to guess the antiderivative of this thing. Well, the antiderivative of secant times tangent is just the secant function. So v is secant theta. Now we apply the integration by parts formula. And I get u times v, that's theta secant theta, minus the integral of v du. And the integral of secant is just one you have to memorize. That's the natural log of the absolute value of secant theta plus tangent theta. So there's our antiderivative, but we still have to transform it back to x space. And if I look back at my original substitution, I see that theta is the inverse secant of x. We replace the secant of theta with x itself, and we proceed into the natural log part. The secant of theta, again, is simply x. But when we hit the tangent of theta, we have a problem because we need now the tangent of the angle whose secant is x. My preferred way to deal with this issue is to draw a little triangle, and we're going to put theta into this triangle right here. Theta is the angle whose secant is x. Secant is hypotenuse divided by the adjacent side. So we can make the hypotenuse x and the adjacent side 1. Then I'm thinking, how do I make the Pythagorean theorem work for this? A little bit of guessing and checking tells us the answer. If the opposite side is the square root of x squared minus 1, and I square that, I get x squared minus 1. I add that to the square of the adjacent side, and I get x squared, the square of the hypotenuse. Now I can see what the tangent of this angle theta is. That's the opposite over adjacent. So the tangent of theta is simply the square root of x squared minus 1. So back to our antiderivative, I have a tangent of theta in there, and that's just the square root of x squared minus 1. Don't forget your plus c. And that's one way to write the final answer. Now the reason I said that's one way to write the final answer is because there are many ways to write this answer. And in fact, when I plugged into a computer algebra system to check my work, I got this answer instead. And we remember that between the properties of trig functions and the properties of logs, there are all sorts of ways you can transform solutions. So I want to take a minute to show that these two are equivalent. The easy part is the trig function part. The angle whose secant is x, let's make a picture of that real quick, that's hypotenuse over adjacent, is the same as the angle whose cosine is 1 over x, that's the adjacent over the hypotenuse. So that's taken care of. What about all this log stuff? I'm going to start by getting common denominators inside the arguments of the log function. So instead of writing 1, I'm going to write x over x. We'll combine that into a single numerator. Same thing for the other one. Okay, since we're going for a minus sign in front of a log, I'm going to factor a negative 1 out of this whole thing, and we'll pull the 1 half out while we're at it. Then I remember that the difference of two natural logs gives me the log of the quotient. So I'm going to take this first argument and divide by the second argument. That's the same as multiplying by the reciprocal. And when I do that, the factors of x cancel. Now it seems like a good idea to multiply by the conjugate of the denominator. Now in the denominator, the cross terms are going to cancel when we multiply, and that's by design. That's what multiplying by the conjugate does. So when I multiply the square root parts together, it undoes the square root and I get x squared minus 1. Then one of my cross terms is positive and the other is negative, so they cancel. And then I get a minus x squared. Well, those x squareds are gone. And then for the numerator, I'm seeing a trick coming here, so I'm just going to write that as square root of x squared minus 1 plus x all squared. And the trick is that with a 1/2 out in front of this natural log, I can move that up into the exponent, and it will undo the squaring. And there's a minor inconvenience here. I'm dividing by negative 1. Well, we're taking the absolute value of it, so we can ignore that. Now, squaring something and raising to the 1/2 power, those cancel each other out. And we've successfully shown that the natural log part that was given by a computer algebra system agrees with the natural log part that we got by hand. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.